start by doing a little bit of I say something, you repeat it back and forth, okay? Because I want to make sure that we rest on, we're coming from the same area. We're actually starting at the same starting point in this service today, this sermon today. It is this: Jesus plus nothing equals everything. Would you all say that with me? Jesus plus nothing equals everything. One more time. Jesus plus nothing equals everything. Early on in my ministry, in fact, it was one of the very first churches that I thought I had a real youth pastor's job. It's because I was married, and it also meant that we had bills to pay, and we were 1,200 miles away from my home. So when we went there after I graduated from college in 1994, I started to latch on to many people I could find that had a northern accent. And I found zero. So I had a friend of mine named Tony with such a deep Louisiana drawl. A little bit of Cajun in his language. And Tony would invite me to his breakfast. And it was a stellar breakfast, let me tell you something. It was right off of the main thoroughfare at this little restaurant. You may have heard of it, McDonald's. And he taught me at this restaurant that the best things that you can get for breakfast were hotcakes. And then he would get hotcakes and sausage because he wanted to put the sausage somewhere under the three hotcakes. And when he came to the sausage, he would say, "There's some meat surprise right there." Which I didn't know was something about some of the food down there was a lot of meat surprise, Tony and I would meet once or twice a month and for breakfast. And basically, it would always start with Tony in his enthusiastic way and saying, "Hey, tell me what Jesus is doing in your life right now. What's Jesus doing?" To get a hold of that kind of enthusiasm. And I soon learned to live into it. Every once in a while, one of his friends would come, and at that same extravagant restaurant with sausage surprise underneath the hotcakes, the three of us would talk about our faith. And this second person that joined us, this third person that joined us, tried to save us. He didn't think we were Christian. He thought that because we did not speak in tongues and had not been baptized by the Holy Spirit, that we weren't saved. I go back to what I said at the very beginning, which you all repeated back to me. I know I do not want you over the next few moments to miss and hear something and then think all of a sudden that I believe something heretical. Because remember, it's Jesus plus nothing equals everything. It's Jesus' work on the cross, his death, his resurrection brings me into right relationship with God. So here I am, being someone who is a project for Tony's friend. And Tony would tell me, "Well, look, you just kind of nod your head at him and you know." But it really started to bother me. Because if in fact there's something special about the Holy Spirit, as we know from the Scriptures, then maybe, just maybe, I'm missing something. You know, the book of Acts is written by this guy named Luke, and in the very beginning of Acts is Luke telling us that 40 days, for 40 days after the resurrection, Jesus appeared to them many times. And Jesus taught them about the kingdom of God. And now the disciples are 40 days into this, which we would call the ascension. Jesus has one more teaching with them, and Jesus is teaching them about the kingdom of God, and the disciples say, okay, Jesus, at this time, are you going to be restoring the kingdom back to Israel? Now, first of all, look, we are like the disciples, that we have this misunderstanding of what the kingdom of God is all about, but that's for another sermon at another time. Let's just agree that at this point, the disciples are tipping their hand to what they expected the kingdom of God to be, and what really God wanted the kingdom of God to be, and what God Jesus had been teaching about the kingdom of God, and what the Old Testament had been saying about the kingdom of God. The disciples tipped their hand because what they expected was this boundary going back to the monarchy of David and the supremacy. We are the ones, and people will come to us and seek you, and we will be the distributors of God to the community and to the world. And Jesus does not answer the question. He says, that's not for you to know. In other words, he said, none of your business. But what I do want you to know in chapter 1, verse 6, 7, and 8, it says, go to Jerusalem, wait there, and you will receive power. And you will be my witnesses. So the disciples in chapter 1, verse 12, they go, they wait. And for another 10 days until Pentecost, they wait. They didn't know it was going to be 10 days. They didn't know anything about how long to wait, but they are waiting. And then chapter 2 opens, and this is how it begins. When the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place, and suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested on each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. They began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And this, I think, is where my friend misunderstood. That there is this manifestation of the Holy Spirit. That there is this manifestation of what is supposed to happen and what is going on. And you have to wonder, what does it mean that the Holy Spirit came and presented itself in this way? Does it mean that every other time that the Holy Spirit comes and fills this place, the two things in that passage say were filled? The sound of the place they were was filled, and the disciples were filled. But does that mean that every single time we become filled with the Holy Spirit, that it is always manifested as speaking in a tongue, in this area, in this situation? The context is being able to say something in a native language and have people from different areas and different languages hear what you're saying in their own tongue or their own ear. So is this the manifestation? Is this always what happens? Look, the disciples did not become Christian at Pentecost. The disciples were already reading, they were studying Scripture, they were already meeting together, they were already serving. They didn't become Christian at this moment. They received something based on God's understanding, the Father's understanding of what the kingdom of God would be like. They received something. although we might say that fear, that the filling of the Holy Spirit actually made him speak in a tongue that was heard in native languages, we can say that when some were filled with the Holy Spirit, they were able to do miracles. But that doesn't happen all the time. But there is one thing that happens all the time. And I will get to that in just a second. When you and I receive Christ, Romans 5:1 says that at that moment we receive through faith, through the agent or the work of Christ, justification. It's a legal term. It's something that is a pronouncement of you are no longer guilty. And no matter how guilty you think you feel, you, in the eyes of God, are not guilty. It's like you and I standing in a courtroom, and we know we did it, and everybody else knows we did it, but the judge says, not guilty. And it's easy to say that people around us might say, but you are guilty, you are guilty. And you might say, well, I am guilty. But the fact of the matter is, the basic gist of it is that we are not the judge. That's what happens when Jesus, his work, atones for our sin and we are justified. It's a lead. We're forgiven. We're brought into this kingdom of God. We're adopted in to something bigger than us, this kingdom of God, this family of God. And that's what happens. But as it unfolds, what happens inside of me is I've been living guilty for so long that I start to believe that I am guilty instead of believing that I'm not guilty. And I start acting and reacting to life as a guilty person instead of one who is forgiven. And that becomes a problem. There's this work of the Holy Spirit that not only cleanses us inside, empowers us, but becomes that spoken word, mouthpiece of God, as Romans 8 says, and his Spirit speaks to our spirit, and we become new. The chaos of life is calmed through the power of the Holy Spirit. And you see that over and over again in Genesis chapter 1, verse 2. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was without void, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. There's chaos there, and the Spirit of God is hovering over the waters. And he said, God said, let there be light, and the chaos became order. And later on in chapter 2, verse 7, then the Lord God formed humanity in the dust of the earth, and got down on his hands and knees, and he breathed into the nostrils the breath of life. The connection here in Hebrew is the spirit. The word for spirit in Hebrew is the same word for breath. And so the breath of God, without that breath of God, that man would have remained dead and lifeless. It was the breath of God that made that man alive. Later on, Jesus picks up on this and he says to Nicodemus, truly, unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. This word again does not mean to do the same thing over again. I'm going to open my Bible. I'm going to open it again. That's a word that Kaleen, the word here is Agathon, and what it means is the only person who can do it again is the person who originally did it. That's why Nicodemus said, does that mean I have to go back into my mother's womb? He understood that if he was going to be born again, not Kaleen, but Agathon, if he was going to be born again, his mother would have to do it. It's like, I have to go back into my mother. No. It goes back further than that. breathed into humanity life. This life-giving, dynamic, energetic Spirit of God is what Pentecost is talking about. And it is not something that comes separately. It is received when you say yes to God. At that moment, when you say, I don't feel like I have power, we can live so long without the power that we may not even realize that we have the power. We realize that we have the Spirit. I love what Ephesians chapter 3 says. Ephesians chapter 3, I'm going to just read it because this must not be on my screen. Ephesians chapter 1, rather, it says this: Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ, listen, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing. You have 100% of the Holy Spirit at the time. What are you saying? I haven't tapped into it, but that's okay. You can't get more and you can't have less. The Holy Spirit. He predestined us for adoption of himself as sons through Jesus Christ according to the purpose, to the praise and glory of his grace, which we have redemption through his blood and forgiveness of our trespasses. And then in verse 8, the riches of this grace through every spiritual blessing that comes from the Spirit, which he has lavished on us, is a word that means overflowing. It means more than you can hold is available. This is the image of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And what happens is we start to release our own hold. We start to rely less on ourselves. It is not easy. It is not easy. Because the older I get, the more I think I know what I should say. And then I start thinking back, and depending on the lens that I'm thinking about that day, I start to reorder things and I start to. I gotta tell you, usually I have a bunch of notes in order exactly the way I want it to go, but this one, I just didn't know how to say it. I didn't know how to unfold it. And I pray, my prayer has been for a couple of days, says God, this is not me not being prepared. It's me not knowing if I can do it. And he said, let me speak and let me just rest. So that's what I've done. So when, how do you know you're filled with the Holy Spirit other than the Scripture? Do you know what is the common denominator of those the Scripture talks about who talk in terms of being filled with the Holy Spirit? Do you know what they did? Some did miracles. Some spoke in tongues. Some raised the dead. Some were at one place and they mysteriously appeared someplace else. 14 times in the New Testament speaks about being filled with the Holy Spirit. The reason I share this with you is because one of the greatest things for every Christian to live into is reality. every single time that it talks about that they were filled with the Holy Spirit, 9 of those times it was in the book of Acts, 1, it's in Ephesians, but it talks about something happening. And this is it. And they became witnesses of Jesus. They testified to what Jesus had done in their life. You see, the reason they were able to speak in that tongue that people could hear and understand so that people would hear about Jesus. What did Jesus say when the Spirit of God, you will remain and you will receive power to be my witnesses? He said, well, that doesn't take much power. You're right. But the effect of that power to make it manifest into something bigger than we are, it takes God. You see, the proclamation, the good news that we should take everywhere is that people are forgiven. And that forgiveness does not depend on me or you. That is a forgiveness that has been declared in heaven. This is God the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. This is the triune God's understanding of the kingdom of God. That forgiveness is declared in heaven. And we proclaim it. We proclaim it by saying, God is forgiving you. And I forgive you. You see, that takes strength, yes. But to move into what it does in people takes the power of God. And that's why thousands and thousands and thousands of people were able to join the church, the growth of the church at that time. Look, you and I, it's easy to be Christian, but it is harder to be a Christian who taps into that Holy Spirit that is in us. Because we wonder, well, what will people think? Let me tell you. It doesn't matter what people think. The fact of the matter is, God has given you and me the ability to walk into our lives and to be His witnesses, not on our own strength. To be witnesses on His strength. That power, that potential power that's flooding inside of us. Acknowledge that you have it. And say, God, Lord Jesus, I know it's you plus nothing that equals everything. But let me be one of your witnesses in this week to come. And declare the good news. That this or that this person or another person is forgiven. The greatest demonstration. Christ Jesus. But Jesus did not say that we had to do it alone. If you live into this week, my prayer is this, that you just admit, at least explore the possibility that you were never meant to do this alone. And the possibility be that you are placed in places right now gracious Heavenly Father, we pray that as we continue to move in and out, take the words that I have spoken today, that if it's not from you, O God, may it fall to the ground and shatter. I can't, you know, O God, how many times I wanted to change title and passage. And then, Lord God, this is, it's like I'm holding a helium balloon that I let go at this time. And I say, now, O God, it is in your hands. Where there is despair, where there is, O God, weakness, or that we are walking alone, O God, help us remember. Let your Spirit speak to ours.